So imagine for a moment that market economies are hardware and economic ideas are the software you run on it. You're all sitting there with laptops. Some of you have Apples. Most of you have Apples. Some of you have iPads, Apple products. Some of you have non-Apple products. They used to be common. Now they're an endangered species. If you drop them on the floor, they have essentially the same components. They've got a motherboard. They have memory. They have certain types of chips that do certain functions. And in a way, economies are very similar. Every economy has a labor market. Every economy has a capital market. The US capital market is enormous, and everybody invests here. The German capital market's tiny. Half their companies don't issue shares. So these hardware institutions, if you will, in capitalist economies, fit together in certain ways. And that limits the type of ideas that you can run on it. Anybody here from Sweden? Any Swedes? No Swedes? Okay, there's a Swede, right. So everybody's favorite little social democracy. Very hard to run American libertarian ideas on Swedish hardware. It's just not going to work, right? So there's compatibility issues. Now, at certain moments in history, big stuff happens. And it causes, if you will, a system reset in the way that we do capitalism. So if you think about the end of the war, World War II, that is, coming after the Great Depression, right across the world, all of the governments of the Western countries decided, regardless how you got there, whether it was the Swedes through Rehn-Meidner and coordinated wage bargaining, whether it was the Americans through cost of living contracts and the Treaty of Detroit, that basically labor needed to be protected. That was the key. Because the 30s and 40s showed that if you didn't do that, they became fascists and millions of people died, which is a really bad idea. So everyone adopted a goal, and the goal was full employment. You had national economies. That is to say, capital had to stay at home and invest at home and was taxed at home. You couldn't just take it where you wanted to get the best return. Everything was cut up into silos. Financial sectors were extremely restricted. You had big labor recognized by the state, big business recognized by the state, bargaining with each other. You had very high taxes, very high transfers. And labor share of income, as I'll show you, was really high, and capital's was low. And a really interesting little factoid was nobody knew the name of the person who ran the central bank. They were totally unimportant, because parliament was dominant, fiscal policy was dominant. Now, cut through the 1980s to basically 2008, and you were in an entirely different world. This is the world that comes after the inflation of the 70s, where there was a system reset, which I'll get into in a minute. Price stability becomes the goal. Globalization of economies becomes the norm. You start to specialize. You integrate your capital markets, your product markets, your labor markets. You open up your financial markets. You flexibilize your labor markets. Taxes drop, transfers drop, capital share increases. And strangely, everybody knows who Alan Greenspan is. But nobody could tell you who the Secretary of the Treasury was. Very different world. Now, as I alluded to, what crashed the first one? That first setup that was working well for labor produced a lot of inflation. Why? Because if you have these tiny little protected national economies and they have strong labor representation, then you've got super tight labor markets all the time. Because you said full employment, we've got to have it. Now what that means is the dumbest person in your firm can leave work at 12 o'clock on a Tuesday and get a better paid job by 4 o'clock on a Friday. The only way business can respond is by pushing up prices. And if you push up prices, what does that do to the real wage? It reduces it. So then labor goes on strike. Welcome to the 1970s.